We will go on. The next speaker will be Alienor Gautier. My French is not so good. A Legion of Concrete, a Comparison of Performance Indicators is the title of the presentation. Please, Alienor, the floor is yours.
Hello, everybody. My name is Alienor Gautier. My supervisors are Benoît Loulin, Emmanuel Rosière, Amel Loukili. The work I will present today was made in collaboration with Van Quantran. So I'm a PhD student, and my thesis is financed by the share between Centrale Nantes and EDISEM. Today, I will speak about the leaking of cement-based mortar, and more particularly about the sensitivity to calcium and carbonate ions. So as you know, in order to be drinkable, water has to go through a whole potabilization process where its chemical composition is going to evolve. What I want to underline is that most of the structures are made of concrete, and so that the water and the concrete are in contact, and that could lead to concrete deterioration. So of course, there are European standards and codes which have been created. So you have some water characteristics like the pH or some concentration of ions like sulfate ions or magnesium ions. Depending on the values you have, you can obtain an aggressivity category. So for example, the XA1 is for water which are not very really aggressive, and XA3 is for water which are very aggressive. And based on these categories, you can have specifications on components proportions or on the minimal strength you need to have for your concrete. So water aggressiveness categories allow a quick classification, but due to that, had to grant several simplifications. And it's not unusual to observe premature deteriorations on structures built in accordance with these requirements. So here you have a picture of a water treatment plant which have been emptied. The picture have been taken after only 3 years of use. You can see that under the level of water, here you have already a huge deterioration, and actually the concrete was complying with the standards I've just talked about. So really the question we want to answer is how we can have as fast deteriorations when the concrete complies with the durability standards. Let's focus on the chemical mechanisms of leaking. So with a pure water, it's really a matter of mineral dissolution. You have first the dissolution of portlandite, followed by the dissolution of monosulfalaminate, etc. The main consequences are, of course, the loss of alkalinity, of mass, and of mechanical strength. The main differences between the leaking by pure water and by mineralized water is the formation of a calcite layer at the edge of the sample. Actually, researchers disagree on the long-term consequences of this precipitation, of this calcite formation, because it's a complex and a dual phenomenon. So we have chosen to use a numerical model in order to investigate the physico-chemical mechanisms of leaking by a mineralized water. My presentation will be in two parts. First, I will show you the use of this numerical model in order to investigate the leaking mechanisms. And then I will show you the use in order to help us to analyze a laboratory experiment. Because the numerical model will help us to analyze the results. And then I will conclude. So, Our numerical model, yes, we used a software which is called TOFReact. It's a software for reactive transport. We had 200 mortar cells in contact with five leaking water cells. In order to have an infinite volume of water, we used volumic factor, huge volumic factor, and the simulated time was 6 months. We simulated four waters. So a first one was a pure water, another one was a mineralized water, and we chose to create two artificial water which are intermediate. Carb one is a pure water in which we have carbonate ions, and carb one Ca1 is a pure water with both calcium and carbonate ions, the same amount than as mineral water. Let's talk about the results. So with our numerical model, we can follow the quantity of calcite which are formed over time. So here it is the result after 6 months. Okay, obviously we have no calcite form with the pure water because there is no bicarbonate ions. With carb one, we have a formation of calcite. The calcium ions come from the portlandite dissolution. With carb one Ci1, we have a huge amount of calcine which are formed. It's because calcium ions were already available in the solution. We were quite surprised to see that the mineralized water induced a low quantity of calcite formed. Actually, it's because of a buffering effect, and it reduced the influence of the presence of calcium ions initially. So we can see that there is more calcite when there is already calcium available in the leaking water, or when there is a low quantity of other ions which are present. We have done the same thing with the portlandites. So here it dissolves, so it's a negative value. Here it's interesting to look at the difference between carb one and carb one Ca1. The only difference between these two water is the presence of calcium. And we can see that there is more calcium when there is more calcium ions in the leaking solution, there is more portlandite leaking. So it's not intuitive. Actually, we need to remember the previous results to understand it. When you have more, and you can see that when you have more calcite which precipitates, you have more portlandite which is dissolved. So maybe the calcite formation acts as a calcium pump, actually. So after having investigated the leaking mechanisms, we have tried to, for now we used artificial water, so we wanted to do it with real water. So we did a laboratory experiment. And because there is a very low variations, of course, we used our numerical model in order to help us analyze the results. So here is a picture of our experimental protocol. We used two different leaking water. The first one, the aggressive water, is actually the mineral water I've just talked about. And the scaling water is the same water with lots of more calcium ions. So each water is in one tank, and the water goes through the samples here with a continuous flow thanks to a pump. So that's it. So experimentally, we could follow the evolution of mass and volume. Here you can see that the scaling water had a gain of mass and volume led to a gain of mass and volume. It means we have more precipitation than dissolution for the scalding water. And of course, it is the opposite here for the aggressive water. We have a loss of mass, of both mass and volume. We could corroborate our results with macroscopic observations, thanks to scanning electron microscopy. So at the left here, it is aggressive water. And you can see there is an increased porosity at the edge here in this zone. Whereas with the scaling water, you can see there is a dense zone at the edge. So it means there is a loss of components for the mineralized water, the aggressive water, and a gain of component for the scaling water. But so because, as you can see, it is very slow modifications. And so we have used our numerical model in order to look at the evolution of each materials, minerals, sorry. So here you can look at the evolution of calcite for a modelization of this experiment. Actually, it is what we expected. We have higher calcite precipitation when we have a higher calcium concentration in the leaking water. We were more surprised by the evolution of portlandite because we have dissolution of portlandite with aggressive water, which is of course normal. But we could see there is precipitation of portlandite with the scaling water. But actually, the answer is in the comparison between the calcium concentration in the leaking water and the calcium concentration in the porous solution. That's explained the portlandite precipitation. So thank you. So I want to conclude. So in our studies, we could observe the complexity and the duality of the calcite formation. So depending on the environmental parameter, you can act as a calcium pump or not. Actually, it underlines the interconnections of the different water parameters. Also, our numerical modeling enables a better parameter tracking and so help us to analyze the results we could have in the lab. So thank you for your attention. If you have questions or advices, actually, I would be happy to hear about them.
Thank you, Eleanor. Very good presentation. Well done. Please, now is time for the questions and the discussions. You will see in the chat the questions. Please read it to make it clear to the audience and then answer it.
Yes. So the first question is, are you able to calculate the strain induced by leaking? This is in order to determine if there is a risk of cracking because of gradient of strain due to leaking. We have not studied the mechanical consequences. We were more focused on the chemical of the physical chemical consequences of the attack. I know that another PhD student before me has used a modeling in order to link the chemical and the mechanical consequences. It was for the external sulfate attack, but I am working on adapting its modeling on the mineralized on the leaking by mineralized water. So I agree that it would be very interesting to study that, but I've not started yet. There is another question.
Yes.
How do you take into account the calcite precipitation on the surface in the transfer properties? How do you measure the volume variations? Yes, so thank you for your question. So in the numerical model, the porosity is evolving during the attack. So when there is a calcite precipitation, the porosity is reduced, and so it modifies the transfer properties. So that's taken into account like this. Experimentally, to measure the volume variation, we use a mass. We measure the mass into water and the mass into the air, and so we have we can have the volume by the difference between the between both measures. I don't know if I'm clear. I think it's a complement in the pore, I understand, but at the surface. Yes, I understand. To answer first, actually, the at the surface, they are very not lots of the main calcite precipitation in our model is at into the porosity. There is not much at the surface really, but there is some. I agree. When there is a gain of materials, the porosity is also modified. The porosity and composition is also modified, and it is the same process. The porosity is decreasing when calcite is forming. Actually, it is taken into account by the same process in the numerical model. I think there is one comment. If water flows on the surface in the device, the effect of abrasion must also be taken into account. I understand. That's why we thought it would be very important to have also laboratory experiments. For now, we have very low flow. That's why we agreed to put it aside, but I agree, and that's why we want to have we have laboratory experiments in order to complete our numerical model. Sure.
Okay. More questions? We have some time, still some time. Motohiro, do you want to make any questions or comments?
Yes, but looks like we have one question in the Q&A from Iveta,
I think. Sorry, I can't see it. Yes. Okay, so the question is, are you gonna introduce some practical solution how to omit damages on concrete, for example, by some special concrete mix design? Yes, really it's the main goal. First, I want to work on an experimental test which would enable the companies and the laboratories to test new concrete, because for now there is no test, leaking tests, which are in standards, and so I want to work on one which would help companies and laboratories. For now, I am comparing different concrete to see if this test is unable to compare really to class the different materials I have. So it's a first step in order to have concrete solution. Really.
This is another question from Catalin.
So what is your opinion about how does calcium leaking affect the properties of the beginning materials? Did you evaluate it after doing the test? The properties, you mean mainly the mechanical properties. Actually, we have not done mechanical tests, but we are trying to know the evolution of the deteriorated depths over time. Because if the deteriorated depths evolves a lot, it means the structure, the mechanical strength of the structure would evolve also. And also the frame would be attacked. But for now, what I can say is that the deterioration depth evolve with the square time, and so it's not a huge depth which is deteriorated. So actually, there is a layer which is formed. So if you let it in place, the deterioration will reduce, and so it will keep a very low dimensions. For now, actually, what I've heard about the companies which are worried about this in the drinkable structure plant, in the drinkable plants, is that they are worried because the dissolutions gives free different aggregates, and they can clog their facilities. Actually, they can deteriorate their facilities, their filter, and everything. Actually, for now, it's more a question, this type of problem that we can observe for now. I don't know if there is other questions.
I think you don't have any other. Is there any other question from the audience?
Yes, I have a simple question, but did you consider the connectivity of pores in your model?
We consider the tortuosity.
Tortuosity, okay.
Yeah.
Because in many cases, let's say, for example, very small micropores may exist next to the larger pores. So even with small precipitation, you may have a blockage in that bottleneck portion. Do you think your model can consider that phenomenon?
Actually, the flow
cannot pass through that bottleneck.
For now, our numerical model doesn't take into account the differences of porosity. So if it's big or not, it doesn't take it into account for now. So.
Yeah, if you find some error or deviations between analysis and experiment, that might be one reason.
Okay.
Thank you.
So you have another question now. Can you see it?
Ah, yes. It seems that you suppose that the apparent diffusivity is proportional to the porosity. In this case, do you think that it would be more complex? There are several laws proposed in the literature, exponential power laws. Yes. So in our model, it's that we have the apparent diffusivity, which is proportional to porosity and tortuosity. Yes, actually, for now, I didn't see any problem that could lead me to look at over diffusivity laws, in my model, there were more problems to have because of the kinetics and everything actually. So if I have some difference between a numerical model and the experimental model, it would I didn't thought of this for now.
Okay. We have 1 minute for the last question. If not, thank you very much, Eleonor, for your presentation. It was very interesting.
And thank you for all your questions. It will help me I will take them into account in my future work. Thank you.